They
talk
don't
about
have nipples.
halflings. They don't.
Dragonborn.
Oh.
They don't have nipples.
Well, let's talk about that in length next time.
So we can just go. That's the beginning. Yeah. The game.
I feel like I might cut that in, actually. Oh my God. All
Totally
right.
should.
I guess we're starting.
Yeah.
Welcome to season two of the game. If you're just joining us, we are a tabletop talk show and podcast brought to you by Dungeon Studios. We go beyond live play and talk about everything from session zeros to campaign heroes. Look at me. If you guys watch season one, I never had that like memorized, and look at me now.
Wow. Yeah, I'm impressed. I've almost memorized it just listening to you saying it for like how
Forever.
long are you doing this now?
Ooh, a year
Must
or
be like
more?
a must be something like I mean you've done it for
I've
longer.
been, yeah.
Yeah. But I
What were
must
you
have
gonna say? You got really close.
was gonna say it must have been about a year.
No, I thought you were gonna say something else.
Something important.
Yeah,
Something
it looked like it.
no, it's
Anyway,
just
folks, we're on YouTube on Tuesdays at 5 p.m. Pacific, 8 p.m. Eastern, 2 p.m. ish New Zealand time.
yep.
Yeah, that's right. Okay.
Also, there are other places in the world as well, and if
There
you live
are.
in them, you could look up the times.
Yes. Yeah,
Yeah.
that's true. We are on in all the world, everywhere. It's the
Yeah.
internet.
It's
All
the
right.
internet.
Today's topic is halflings.
Yeah.
I always say I'm excited to talk about these topics, but I am because, as I mentioned last time, dwarves, elves, we've covered that now. Dwarves and elves are like the iconic fantasy races, if you will. And I feel like now we're going to start getting into some of the crunchier type of races that you don't get to see very often. So I don't
Halflings
know.
is a funny one, isn't it? Because they are kind of hobbits. They're like the D&D proprietary hobbits.
Yes.
Well, they did get sued back in the, was it the 70s? They got sued by the Tolkien estate for using the word hobbit, so they changed it to halflings. So
That is exactly what I was going to bring up. My research on the topic today was like, I could not find anything on halflings before Tolkien. And then with Tolkien, it was like,
boom.
yeah, D&D or TSR. Tried to use hobbits in 1974 with one of their like original releases, and sure enough, yeah, legal eagles were like, you can't do that.
Yeah. I
However,
feel they did the same thing.
the word halfling was also used by Tolkien, and so
Yeah.
but I guess it's not a proprietary name, so they could use it. So
Right.
even the word halfling, I couldn't find any mention of before Tolkien, which is just really interesting. So
That is, yeah, because like the elves and the dwarves, we can trace that stuff all the way back into like the Icelandic sagas and all sorts of other cultural historical stuff. But
yes.
halflings, they're just Tolkien. There's
Yeah.
like the 50s or the
I mean,
40s that was
as
written.
a legacy, I feel like that's super cool. Like, you
Impressive.
created a word that is like, to my knowledge, that's a commonplace word. You say halfling, for the most part, I think anybody, even if you're not into D&D, would at least have some idea what that is. Everybody knows it.
Have
Right?
you watched what is that TV show about Uhtred of Babenberg? I'm trying to think of the name of this TV show. It's quite good, but he's always calling people arslings.
Haven't heard of it, but now I need to look it up.
Yeah, it's
That's
quite funny.
amazing. So, yeah, I mean, halflings are technically, their origins are D&D and Tolkien. That's it. They don't go back further than that. So there wasn't a lot of history. Uh-oh. There
Good.
wasn't a lot of history to look into, which was
Oh.
different. I
Well, I
mean,
mean, unless you go into the Silmarillion, I guess. I don't even know if they're in there. I haven't read it.
yeah, there was no mention of it when I did my research.
Okay.
So what is a halfling? What is a halfling? I mean, if you had no idea, right? Come on,
Right.
folks, who hasn't watched the Lord of the Rings movies or read the books? But
Hobbit and et cetera. Yeah.
if you live under a rock and you have no idea what a halfling is, what's a halfling?
Well, it's a great question. I mean, I remember when my mother gave me the book The Hobbit as a child. It's like must have been six or something to read. And
That's some heavy reading for a 6-year-old.
well, just The
It's not a
Hobbit.
big book, but still, the words, they're
Actually,
so.
I think she read it to me the first time through, and then I read it again.
Okay.
Either that or she read me the beginning of it and I got hooked, actually. I think that's what happened. I read it, but that's right. That's how I learned to read. I remember now. Yes, it was the first book I read. Anyway,
Wow.
the point being that when someone gives you a book called The Hobbit and you've never heard of a hobbit, you're like, what the fuck is a hobbit?
Right.
What is that? There's like there's no way my brain ever would have leapt to a small, childlike, slightly
Humanoid.
humanoid creature that was basically a metaphor for the average British boring person who couldn't go out exploring anywhere, you know,
Right.
and but loved their life and happiness and sitting around in homely environments and little hobbit houses and having festivals and cooking, etc. You know, no
Yeah.
one's gonna jump to that conclusion. I thought a hobbit was a monster.
You know, it does kind of, if you had no
Yeah.
preconceived notions, yeah, a hobbit kind of sounds like a monster.
The Hobbit sounds like a monster, like a hobgoblin or something like that. I don't know.
Yeah.
But yeah, so what is a hobbit actually?
Yeah.
Or halfling. Let's not call them, well, we might get sued by the Tolkien estate, so we also should call them halflings.
We should
Because
call them halflings.
at least wizards can't sue us because they've already, you know, proven that case has been settled.
Exactly. Yes. So halflings, as the word implies, are like the size of half of a human.
Right.
And to my knowledge, here's where things get a little muddy. If you had no idea, like when I first started playing D&D, I was so confused. I'm like, what's the difference between a halfling and a gnome? Because they're both like little people.
Right.
And the way that my DM explained it to me, and it might be different now, but the way my DM explained it to me was like, well, gnomes are like little people, like their proportions are kind of like dwarf-like, but small. Whereas halflings have the proportions of a human. Like they're not, you know, thick gutted, or they don't have bulbous heads, or you know, like they have the proportions of a human. They're just half the size. And that stuck with me visually. I don't know if that's actually the case now, because I know rules have kind of changed.
Yeah, I was going to say fifth edition. If you look at the art in fifth edition, you'll see in that edition the hobbits, the halflings do indeed have bulbous heads. They are a sort of strange proportion in that.
Really?
I
Okay.
personally just go through the artwork in the player's handbook,
Yeah.
and you'll see it. It's there. And it does seem to sort of be recurring throughout fifth edition if you come across halfling pictures, as opposed to previous editions where they were just like hobbits, you know,
Yeah.
just smaller people that
Yeah.
were shorter and typically looked a bit younger and you know. But yeah.
And the other thing too, I don't know. Again, I should have gone back to the player's handbook, but you know, hobbits have the hairy feet. I don't
Right.
think halflings are mentioned as having hairy feet. I think that might be one thing that they changed, right?
Right. I mean, I don't think there's probably no reason why you can't have a halfling with hairy feet. And
Yeah.
I think in the movies and in the books they don't typically wear shoes very often either.
Right.
Whereas I think if I'm playing a halfling, my character probably has boots.
Boots, yeah. Yeah.
Won't go adventuring without boots.
Yeah. So they're typically half the size of a human. They are described as resembling human children or adolescents, I think. Yeah, I guess you could choose not to. You could choose to look old.
Yeah. Old halflings for sure.
Yeah. They have friendly demeanors. Again, if you're going back to the Lord of the Rings books, think about those happy little halflings just sitting there enjoying life. And you, like you said, they don't necessarily want to leave home, but they kind of have an adventurous spirit.
Right. I mean, they're really like if you take the idea of the reluctant hero,
Yeah.
right? That kind of idea, this call to adventure, and in the sort of standard mythological cycle begins with the call to adventure and the refusal to the call to adventure. And the
Right.
halfling just sums that up. You take that first scene in the Hobbit movie, you know, where what's his name? Frodo, is it Frodo? Bilbo, I'm sorry. Bilbo's at home and
Yeah.
all the dwarves start turning up.
Yes.
Right? That's the call to adventure. And he's like, fuck no, I don't want anything to do with this shit. And then over time, he sort of gets broken down to the point where he's like, okay, I have to do this. And then even when he starts, he wants to go home again. And then he, you know,
Yeah.
realizes the gravity of the situation.
Yeah,
So.
and even though it's like even though he didn't want to, there you could tell that there was some part of him that was intrigued at least, but
Right.
still like I don't know. It's almost like you see this struggle between their, you know, the courage, the lack of courage and their bravery in situations.
Right.
So there's, it's a really cool
aspect
to them that I like.
Yeah. And they sort of really embody that call to adventure and refusal to that.
Yes.
Interesting.
Yeah. The other thing that they call out here is their love of home and food and comfort, which you can see, I think, especially in the Lord of the Rings movies when they go to the tavern and they're just having their big giant, you know, tankards compared to their size of their body. And
he's coming pints.
Yeah. You know, and 11sies and, you know, second lunch, second dinner, second whatever breakfast. It is. Like
snack and breakfast. It's not had second breakfast yet.
I'm pretty sure I'm a hobbit in my previous life. Okay, offshoot here. I'm going to share on my own channel at some point, but I went to Disneyland. I flew. And with me, I took a picture. I packed food and snacks that I brought with me from home on the plane to my hotel room because, and I laughed when I realized this, once I realized how much I had more food in my luggage than I had clothes. And it's not because, I mean, I am kind of a fat kid at heart and I love food, but I realized there was this whole other side of me. I went digging into my past and realized there's kind of a little bit of trauma there about going hungry. So that's all going to be on my channel, folks, but just, I just realized I'm a hobbit. Like, I just have to make sure I have my food. I have to have my breakfast and my snack and my 11sies. And I have to know when my next meal is going to be.
Right. I mean, I think we all like to think of ourselves as heroic characters, you know, elves and nobility and so on.
Yeah.
But most of us are just hobbits.
Exactly. So the other cool thing that I really thought was interesting about hobbits / halflings is that there's not a lot of change to the lore. If you look at what you know about hobbits for Lord of the Rings,
right,
it is almost identical in D&D lore. There's very little change, which you can't really say the same about dwarves or elves or any of the other races we're going to go through probably.
Right. Yeah. I mean, the other thing too, is that I got the impression from my own research that Gary Gygax didn't really like Lord of the Rings. I mean, he was more into the sort of sword and sorcery, Conan the Barbarian, lots of other stuff. I'm trying to think of all the other things. My brain's shut down, but that's okay.
That's interesting to know, though, that he didn't really like it. It must have been more of a public outcry for, we want to play hobbits.
I think he played a lot of D&D, obviously, because he made it, and met a lot of people who wanted to play different characters and must have gotten many requests for it, or just realized that. Because at that time, they were stealing stuff from, when I say stealing, I mean creatively appropriating things from all sorts of other places, including Call of Cthulhu and, you know, Lovecraft stuff and blah, blah, blah. I mean, as we said before, TSR got sued by the Tolkien estate, but they also got sued by Lovecraft's estate. And they ended up having to republish at least one book because of that, taking out Cthulhu and other creatures from it. So, yeah, they were trying to put everything into D&D. I think they were sort of looking for the widest possible audience. And sales was probably the driving force.
Interesting. Well, let's see. I mean, like I said, I thought that was really cool that they didn't change a lot of that, you know, the name alone, and leave it because it's good, you know. What else do we know about halflings? They're lucky. They're very lucky, which, again, going back to the movie, it's like, how is this tiny little creature that can't, it's not very strong, it's not very fast.
Not even
you're supposed to survive dragons and dungeons and things. How do you?
And dragons.
Exactly. Go figure. You must be lucky. So they have this inherent luck that I think is great that they added that in there. And then I think, they're kind of known. They could be used as, you know, for stealth and trickery. I think that also lends itself to the Hobbit.
Right. I mean, he's a burglar.
They
hired him as the burglar. That was the title that Gandalf gave him in the book, right? So, and obviously they're small and dexterous.
Yeah.
So it makes sense.
So, you know, in the last couple episodes when we did Dwarves and Elves, I tried to find some examples in you know, today's media that we can point to and go, oh, if you don't know what a halfling is, here you go. And really, right. I mean, except for hobbits.
No one else will touch it now, I think. I think that's the thing. Yeah.
Well, there is. I did find one mention. Oh. One mention, and that is in the Forgotten Realms books with Drizzt. There is a halfling rogue named Regis. I'm assuming I'm pronouncing that right. Regis. So, Regis. Yeah, halfling rogue, member of the Companions of the Hall.
Hmm, interesting. And that's in the books, huh?
That's what it says.
So, because they will appear in some of the old Forgotten Realms books, I'm sure of that. They won't be in Dragonlance, because the curious thing is that there is yet another iteration of the halfling, which is the Kenda.
Right? Yeah.
They are kind of an offshoot from the concept of a halfling. They're not halflings, really. They're their own race, but they're very much based on halflings. They're small, diminutive people that look a lot like halflings. They're fearless, a lot like halflings, but they're kleptomaniacs and they live in tribes.
I love it.
Yeah. Oh, I mean, and Eberron, we were talking to Keith Baker a few weeks about Eberron. And of course, you've got, he likes to turn all of these tropes on their heads. So the halflings in Eberron are running around on the backs of dinosaurs and with spears hunting and such. So they're very different halflings there.
Wow.
So that's kind of cool.
That is cool. Right. Yeah, and I just realized I'm saying, you know, halfling in Forgotten Realms. Forgotten Realms is a D&D. Setting. So of course, anyway, that makes sense. But in case you weren't familiar with Lord of the Rings, you might have been familiar with Drizzt and his halfling companion.
Right.
Let's see. Oh, yeah. I did want to touch on any lore for halflings. If you're creating a halfling, they have, just like most races, have their own pantheon of deities and things like that. I was curious. Yeah. What deities do halflings have? So there's Yandala, protector and provider, embodies protection, fertility, and looking after halflings in their community. So it sounds like Yandala is probably, the principal.
She's the principal halfling deity, A name worth remembering if you're going to play a halfling or DM a halfling. If there are halflings in your game, all you need to know is Yolanda.
Yandala.
Yandala, So you're talking about remembering the names.
Right. Well, I mean, Yolanda's close enough. You can
just change it to that. Yolanda. It's in my campaign world. It's Yolanda. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. I think the reason I think of Yolanda is because of Pulp Fiction.
Oh, is there a Yolanda there?
Yeah. Any of you motherfuckers move and I'll execute every last motherfucking one of you.
Bam, bang, oh, man. So there's another halfling deity, Arverine. The Vigilant Guardian, vigilance, wariness, defense, mostly for halfling warriors, for protection and martial prowess. And then there's Brandobaris. The halfling deity of stealth and trickery and thievery. So master of stealth. So halfling rogues, I guess, if you pray to a deity.
Yeah.
It would be Brandobaris. Are you looking up how to sound it out?
I'm actually just looking up the deities, the halfling deities, because I am curious to see the full pantheon.
Right. I mean, it's one thing, you know, if you think of deities, I don't know, you think of these grand images, you know, large animals or, you know, godlike beings that hover in clouds, and I'm actually curious what these visual representations of a halfling god would be. Are they small people? Are they these big things? Because that's the opposite of what they are. So that would be the grand thing. I would love to see what these things look like.
So quick question for you too, on a very related note. You no doubt saw the new Lord of the Rings TV series, the one that came out.
Rings of Power,
Rings of Power, right. And, of course, there's whole story arcs in there involving halflings or hobbits in that case.
Yeah. Did they call them brownies, though, in that show? Were they brownies?
No, okay. They did have another term that they did use sometimes, but they were hobbits. But the thing that was interesting to me was, given that it was Lord of the Rings, which is the world that hobbits and halflings originated from, they presented them quite differently to the hobbits of the Shire.
Yeah.
Which we see later in the Lord of the Rings and Hobbit movies.
Right. Know?
They were sort of more tribal. They went around in wagons. They lived out in the forest.
They were like more nomadic, these ones.
Yes. I thought that was really cool. I really liked that scenario. And of course, they had all different races as well, which was interesting as well.
Yeah. Yeah, that's actually a really good point. It's almost like they were kind of showcasing the different sub races, if you will, of halfling. You know, there's like the forest or hill dwelling ones, and then now there's the forest nomadic ones.
Right. And no doubt there's the Shire hobbits, which are more sort of farmer pastoral.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, super cool.
I think the other thing, before you go on, the other thing about that specific scenario is, we were talking about how the hobbits, especially in Lord of the Rings, are presented as this kind of, here is an opportunity to look at the hero's journey and the call to adventure. And the Shire hobbits, Bilbo particularly, and then Frodo, resist the call to adventure.
Yeah.
I feel like the hobbits, or the main character hobbit, at least in the other one, she was quite keen.
She was. She was ready.
She was into it, right? She was like, call to adventure? Where? I'm ready. Let's go.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true. Yeah, I like that. It does showcase how they can be very different.
Mm.
So talking about sub-races, there are a few different options here if you're going to be a halfling. The two main that I think have been around since the beginning of halflings, you can correct me if I'm wrong, are the Lightfoot and the Stout halfling, right?
Right, right.
So the Lightfoot, I'm assuming, they're more naturally stealthy, whereas the Stout are more resilient. They have like a higher constitution bonus, so they can take the hits versus being really fast.
I feel like this is the difference between the kind of bobblehead halfling and the more naturalistic halfling too, you know?
That
feels like that might be a thing. It could be.
Now that you say bobblehead, literally that's how I'm envisioning it, is like this halfling with like a...
right.
Oh, gosh.
Fifth edition art, they're like...
Yeah. Huge.
Yeah.
Yeah. So besides the Lightfoot and the Stout Halfling, Sword Coast Adventurer's Guide has what's called a Ghostwise Halfling. I hadn't heard of this, so I was reading into this. Super cool. But they trace their ancestry back to a war among halfling tribes that sent their ancestors into flight from Lurin. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that correctly. Anyway, Ghostwise Halflings are the rarest, and they are found only in a certain area, Chondal Wood, and few other isolated forests. They have clan warriors known as Night Gliders. These are cool. These sound really cool. They ride giant owls as mounts. They're clannish. They're very, like, you know, they have clans. They're mistrustful of outsiders. And they have silent speech. You can speak telepathically to any creature within 30 feet of you. It's really interesting. I'm trying to figure out.
They're great assassins or something, wouldn't they?
Yeah, ghost-wise. But, like, it sounds like they're into the, you know, the night and the shadows. And
ghost-wise phantom rogue.
Yeah, yeah. Explorer's Guide to Wildemount has a Lotus Den halfling. I hope I'm pronouncing that one correctly. It looks like Lotus Den. These, when I read into it, sounds more like the druid of halflings. Children of the woods, they know the druid craft cantrip. They also learn the entangle and the spike growth spell. And they have what's called Timberwalk. And they can... ability checks made to track you are at disadvantage, and you can move through difficult terrain made of non-magical plants and overgrowth without expending extra movement. So, and the way that they title it Timberwalk makes me imagine that they're just literally running through the limbs of trees.
We were talking about this with elves. You remember us telling us that's what I wanted to do with my elves.
Yeah.
So there's a mechanic for that.
I guess so. Yeah. Look up Timberwalk.
Right.
And then you were talking about Eberron. So there's Eberron rising from the last war. There are halflings with mark of hospitality.
Right. Yes.
Which, if I'm reading into it, sounds like they're kind of a healer.
It's not really healing. It's like they have the, from what I could gather, they have the, I guess that all of their traits are kind of designed for running hotels.
Oh yeah, running taverns. I read it now. Yeah, they've got brewers, tools, cook's utensils, purify food and drink.
I mean, for a dragon mark, it's a bit sad, to be honest. But
right, I mean, it could be fun. Yeah, you're right. It could be fun, but the utility of it while adventuring is like you're going to be preparing food for your group.
I think that it's cool from a factional point of view, like that there is a house that does this thing. It serves the economy of the world more than it serves the kind of creative need to make player characters interesting.
Right. Yeah. And then there's also from Eberron, Mark of Healing. Ah, this is the one that is. Yeah. So medical intuition, they come with, herbalism kit, healing spells, restoration. So interesting. And those are those specific, I'm going to ask you, you might not know, but you've been kind of delving into Eberron lore lately. So are those specific to halflings, or are they just, happen to be available to halflings?
Yes, no, they are. How the dragon marks in Eberron serve like subclasses.
Okay.
So if you want to play a dragon-marked halfling, you've got those two choices.
Okay, and I see.
Those are they become your subclass.
Okay.
Sorry, I'm so sorry. It's not subclass, sub-race.
Okay.
Race. Yeah. So they're like a type of halfling with a dragon mark. They have these traits because they have the dragon mark.
Okay. So
rather than being a lightfoot halfling, you're a mark of hospitality.
Halfling. Got it. Interesting. Interesting.
Yeah.
So we have talked in the past about min-max builds. And if you were going to build like the best halfling, what are some of the things you want to look into? Right.
Wow. What a strange idea.
to min-max a halfling.
Right. I mean, how many people would play a halfling and why? What do you get from being a halfling, right? What's the...
Well, I've got a story for you later, because in the game that I play in, our halfling, the guy who plays the halfling, is like MVP every single time. He is our utility healer slash fighter slash magic caster. Like, he can do it all. He has built this thing pretty crazy. It's amazing. So I can't wait to tell you about it later. But yeah, I don't know why, but he's done it.
Right. I mean, what is it that a halfling will bring to your character that is mechanically superior to any other race or subrace in the game?
So I will tell you, number one, it's luck. I think it's luck.
That's true. Right.
Yeah.
Rerolling natural ones.
Right. Rerolling natural ones It was for attacks and ability checks and saving throws. So that covers almost everything there. And you just get to reroll a one. You never have a nat one. Like,
I mean, you can, because if you reroll it and you reroll another one, you can still fail.
That's true.
So it's not like you can't fail, but it's twice as hard.
Yeah. So I would say for the luck is probably the main reason why you would choose a halfling. And you can kind of build into their dexterity. Like you said, you can build them to be very quick, especially if you choose like the lightfoot halfling, right?
Yeah. I mean, the other one, the stout one, is more like a dwarf, probably.
Yeah.
More out of a dwarf for the same thing.
Yeah. Yeah. So let's see. So if you were going to do a halfling, if you're going to do a lightfoot halfling, let's say, you get the charisma bonus, and then you get, you choose either a bard or sorcerer warlock for the charisma, because you get the charisma bonus.
Paladin?
Oh, paladins. What do they use for their charisma? Is it charisma? Oh, I guess you could go paladin. Do paladins have dexterous builds? Can you do that?
There are actually dexterous paladins.
Okay.
One of my players built a dex-based archer paladin.
Okay. Oh, yeah, there you go. A distance fighter.
Yeah. I mean, she was still quite kick-ass up close, but that's what she was built for, was a dex-based paladin.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you could definitely go that route. Let's see. So yeah, rogue, bard, sorcerer, warlock would be, or paladin, like you said, if we're going to dig into the charisma. And then, because they're already lucky, you also take the lucky feat and stack up, right? This, to me, is the most broken thing ever, because you can already, I actually looked up rules on this because people have been questioning this. Imagine you're a halfling,
right?
You roll a one.
Yep.
You use your racial racial feature to be able to re-roll the one, and now you've rolled a three, and you're like, shit.
Yeah, like
but that. If you take the lucky feat, you can actually use the lucky feat and re-roll it again.
So
and
what's
you
the,
get that three times a day.
Oh my God, really?
Yeah.
How does the lucky feat work? It just means you can re-roll anything you roll, or...
So the way the lucky feat works, it says whenever you make an attack roll, ability check, or saving throw, which is the same thing for the racial feat, you can spend one luck point to roll an additional d20. You can choose to spend one of your luck points, you can choose to spend one of your luck points after you roll the die, but before the outcome is determined.
Right.
You choose which of the d20s is used. So that's the other thing. You can choose which one is used.
Kind of giving yourself advantage, aren't you?
Kind of, yeah. But you can also use it against, like, if someone's attacking you, you can force them to re-roll. So instead of, like, I rolled crappy, I want the enemy to roll crappy, right?
Yeah, so it's like silvery barbs.
Right. So how broken would it be if you're like, ah, crap, I rolled a one, let's use my racial feat, now I rolled a three, and now I use a luck point, and you could choose to use all three of your luck points if you want until you roll well, but you can do that three times a day. Super broken.
I don't know. It's an interesting thing. I mean, certainly these things sound really cool, but how many people choose to play these things? How many people choose this stuff? Because to me, you're sacrificing a whole bunch of much more interesting flavor to have luck, which mechanically is cool, but narratively means nothing.
I'm telling you that it is wild the number of people that do this. I might. I guess it depends. You know, if I were playing in a game where I knew my DM was like an evil DM and I'm going to die, oh, hell yeah, I'm going to pick that. But if it was like any other regular game, I'm the kind of player that prefers, you know, to add some weakness into my character just for fun. So I wouldn't go this route. But min-max is something that I, like I said, I've been opening my eyes. Yes, I've been opening my eyes to the fact that min-max is, it is more prevalent than I thought. Let's just say that. So I mean, that's why I bring it up, because I want to cover that part of our audience that doesn't play like we do.
Right. I think the other thing too, from my point of view, is like D&D is obviously the biggest role-playing game around, and there are other games. Mm-hmm. And it feels to me that if you want to embrace the spirit of D&D, there is a little bit of min-maxing. D&D does have that whole battle game, war game sort of history that's come through to it. It's inherited this whole kind of combat-oriented aspect to it. So it's at least, if you go by the three pillars of D&D, which is combat, role-playing, and exploration, it's very heavily weighted towards the combat. If you look through the books, it's all about the combat and the mechanics for the combat. They don't give you anything about how to explore the world or how to role play. That stuff's not really built into the mechanics at all. There are other games that do that. So if you're going to play D&D, there is a mechanical combat oriented min-maxing kind of...
It's kind of ingrained. The culture of it is ingrained in the material that you're given when you learn it.
Exactly. It's in the material. It's in the game. It's built that way. You can play it differently, and there's nothing wrong with that. And I do play it differently, as do you by the sounds of it. But certainly the average person who picks up the player's handbook and starts playing D&D is going to assume this is a combat-based game, and they're going to try and min-max because they've been used to playing video games and other games where that is useful.
Right.
You want to get through the game. You assume you're going to be in combat. You're going to need to make your character mechanically sound.
You know, the other thing I notice is min-maxing, I think, is a way... So, you know, when you're learning how to draw, and you will take some wonderful piece of art that you've seen and put like the tracing paper on top of it, and you learn how to trace the lines, and from that you learn how to draw it yourself.
Right.
Think that min-maxing to some extent helps new players understand how to build characters, because this is, again, aside from the books, when they go out into the internet and they're like, I need help building my my halfling rogue, they're gonna get half, at least half of the comments they're going to get are from people saying, you need to take the lucky feat because blah, 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 you know, and they do it because they're hearing from their peers, this is what you should do. And eventually, I think they, once players get enough confidence in themselves that they understand the material, they might start straying away from it.
I agree. I totally agree with that. I think that it's got a lot to do with who your DM is as well. Like if you're going into a game where you don't know the DM and you don't know the other players, you need to min-max because they might well not be role-playing kind of oriented. They might well be dungeon crawling oriented. And if that's the case, your character is going to stand out like dog's balls.
Right.
And
you're going to feel like you're not helpful.
You're not helpful. Yeah, exactly. And all the role-playing in the world isn't going to make up for the fact that your character is probably going to die. And, and you might be the cause of other people's characters' deaths as well, which won't be fun for the group.
Right.
So you need to play a character that works for the group.
Right.
So min-maxing in those cases.
Yeah. Yeah, it makes sense.
And this, the sorry, just to say one little thing, add to that, I think that you're kind of obligated to do a little bit of min-maxing in D&D.
Yeah.
Especially D&D, because your other players are going to be relying on you. It is a team game.
Mm-hmm.
And there is a 95% chance that there's going to be combat in your game, and you need to be part of the team. And so if everybody else is min-maxed and you're not, then you're just dragging them down.
You can you'll feel the imbalance, I think, in the party.
Yeah, and
so
it's not
it is something to consider.
People, you know, when other people have spent time building their characters in a way that are actually going to incorporate stuff that's going to work for the group. And if you're just like, oh, my character is just from the woods and stumbled into this thing, doesn't really want to be here, doesn't really have any interest in the thing, just floating along, and I'm happy doing my own role-playing thing. That's cool, but yeah. Anyway, sorry.
So on to, really quick, I just want to touch on my friend's bard that he created, his halfling bard, but you have something really interesting to share, which I can't wait to get into. So I'll just really quickly tell you. So in the game that I play in, we did not have a cleric. And so the bard took it upon himself. Like he didn't decide when he created his character that he was going to take healing spells and things like that. But he quickly realized we don't have a cleric. And the only other magic user is a sorcerer.
Right.
And
so he stepped up.
He's not really the sorcerer isn't really going to heal too much. So he started building himself out as a healer, but we also didn't have a rogue. So then he started building himself out as like this rogue slash healer slash he's the face of our group. He's the leader of our group in this very weird sense. Mm-hmm. And it is crazy. It is such a, I don't know how to explain it, but he pulls through in a clutch every single time. We could have three players down, one's rolling on their third death saving throw, and somehow this guy will just pull it out of his ass and save us all. It's the best build I've ever seen. If he would let me share his character sheet, I would do it.
Will he let you?
I don't know. I have to ask him. It just came up. Right. But it's funny because the creation of his character, I've talked about him before. His name's Yu. He was raised as like this slave. He was taken from his parents and raised as a slave. And so he never knew his real name. And so he thinks his name is Yu, Pitiful Creature. And so we call him you. And from that, we have so many stupid gags in game because it's like, I gave the map to you. Who, me? No, you. You know, and that happens all the time. And after playing this same character for, 8 years with the same party, the stupid wow. joke is still funny.
What level are you guys?
We're level 16 and we're getting ready to go to the end. Yeah. It is like the most open sandbox world we have ever been in. It's wild. But anyway, and then because he's our de facto leader, because he's the face, when our DM said, you guys have too much money to physically carry it around. You need to do something with all your money. We bought out and created an airship company and we call it use guys. You fly them, or what is it? It was something like you buy them, we fly them. I can't remember. Right. It's a cargo shipping company / we can transport people too. We're still building it out. But yeah, so he is like our leader of our group. We have stickers with you all over them. Use guys. And anyway,
hilarious.
So much fun. So you can definitely use a halfling and build them out to just be about anything you need them to be is what I feel like I've learned from that.
So you're feeling that the halfling is a very versatile sort of character.
I think so. I mean, like I said, if we needed a healer, he made a healer. We needed a rogue, he made a rogue.
Would it be more or less diverse and what's the word I just used? But anyway, than a human, like which would be the more dynamic?
I don't know, to be honest, because humans do get a lot of extra things just for being human, right? Like it's almost like an incentive, I think, the player's guide gives you to choose human, because who wants to be human? So they kind of throw some extra stuff your way.
The thing I've always felt with humans in D&D, at least coming back from like first edition through to now, is that humans are like the average sort of benchmark for all the species, and everybody else, like they're all their stats are kind of flat.
Right.
Whereas any other species kind of starts to tilt
one way or the other. I see what you're saying. Other, you know? Yeah.
So you can play a human paladin or a human sorcerer or a cleric or whatever, and it's always going to work.
Right.
You play a dwarven, originally a dwarven wizard, what wouldn't really work because they're intelligence based and dwarves didn't have bonuses to intelligence. So
yeah.
So you wouldn't do that. But with humans, of course, it's across the board, and halflings.
I don't know. I mean, because, you know, imagine building like a halfling barbarian. Would that work?
Yeah.
I think so. I mean, because. Mechanically. You know, it's not like they don't get strength bonuses, but then you've got the lucky feat going or the lucky racial ability going on. So at least you have that. I do think that they can fit anywhere, I think, halflings. Yeah,
I think absolutely. And especially for story reasons, if you're absolutely out to min-max and you're starting from the point of view that I just want to make the most powerful barbarian,
you
want to use a halfling. But if you want to make the most powerful halfling, you might choose a barbarian.
Oh, that's a great way to put it. I love that. So now I want to hear about this PDF solo adventure that you created for.
Okay. Well, I have a new player in one of my campaigns. His name's Jerry. He's the loveliest guy you will ever meet, by the way. And Jerry made this character Jilyara, or Ilyara. Sometimes I call him Ilyara. So he's a male character, this halfling. Some of the other players were away, and I only had him in one game session. So I thought, well, let's do a flashback. Let's go back
to
his backstory, and we're going to play through his backstory. And of course, you know, we know the rules for flashbacks. The player character pretty much can't die. So there has to be some sort of deus ex machina backup kind of thing to pull out of your ass if absolutely necessary. So I had a whole bunch of lore about halflings in my world. They, for example, the elves call them the paradil. So they have a name. There's other words than halflings that are more common than the term halfling in my world. Mm-hmm. So we don't have to call them hobbits or halflings. They're the paradil. And so he comes from this town called Twaddle, and there's a little map here that made an incarnate of Twaddle.
Before you get too far,
yeah.
In our little blah blah description, hopefully, most likely, there will be a link to this PDF, which Russell here has created. So you can follow along with us as he's going through.
Yeah, please do. And the thing, too, to remember while we're talking about this particular adventure is this particular adventure is a solo adventure for a specific player with a specific character based around building out his backstory. Right. So this is not a game. This is not a scenario that you can probably run very easily. You could adapt it. I'm sure you could adapt it.
Right. But yeah. Use it as a template.
You can use it as a template. But the thing that's important here, I think, is that to me, this is how I go about creating an adventure for an individual single player in a solo environment that is especially tailored to that character, you know? And so everything that happens in this adventure is designed to shed light on theme, plot, or character involving this character specifically, right? So the basically the storyline here is that, I had to ask Jerry a couple of questions before we started, and I sort of said to him, you know, there's going to be a couple of points where I'm going to be adding to your character in ways that I want your permission for. For example, there is an NPC here in this town. He goes back to his hometown for the harvest festival. That's the basic setup. And when he gets back to his hometown, his ex-girlfriend, who was always a bit weird, and she cooks, she makes the best pies for the Yolanda, Yondala's blessings is the name of the pies, and they're part of the ceremony for the festival of the harvest festival, and they're absolutely necessary, but she's kind of lost the plot. And as the player's sort of going around town, bumping into people that they know and go visiting his family and visiting other people, beginning to realize that his ex, this girl that he left to go off to become a cleric. He left her to become a cleric. His religious training took him away from her. And okay. So they broke up, right? So he comes back to town and he's sort of feeling a bit like, I don't know if I want to bump into her. But then he finds out she's being weird, doing strange things, starts digging into this. And then he starts following her, and this leads them out into the forest, where he discovers that she has made a pact with a hag.
Ooh.
Right. And the hag is manipulating her to try and ruin the harvest festival and burn down the elders' hall.
Oh.
And the hag is using the fact that this other NPC in the story stole an heirloom from her, which was a magic knife, a magic cake cutter. That was the thing that she needs to make the best pies. That's how she's always made the best pies, you see, but he's stolen it. And now he's making the best pies, and nobody believes that, none of the other halflings in the village believe her. And so she's really upset with everybody. And so she goes and makes this deal with this hag, basically, and she's had this heirloom stolen. So that's kind of the basic setup. And Giliara comes into town, finds this, you know, she's doing all these strange things, follows her out into the forest, bumps into this celestial stag who actually is an NPC in the world and doesn't particularly impact this plot, except to say that he was my deus ex machina of the shit goes down.
Oh, right. So it's like, what is it? They call it the Chekhov's gun. He's your Chekhov's gun. You had to show it somewhere in the beginning so that if you needed to use it in the end, it made sense.
Yes, exactly.
I like that.
Exactly. That's and in the movies they say, you know, set up, pay off. If you set it up, you have to pay it off, right? If it's there, you have to do something with it. Don't put something in the story that you're not going to use.
Yeah.
Of course, D&D is different. You've got to have everything in there just in case you need to use it. But you still, at the same time, you can pare it down as much as you can, especially because I had to fit this into 3 hours, right? And that was hard work.
Yeah.
So looking through here, the key events were the sort of discovery at the market. Giliara witnesses firsthand Polly's troubled state. Her pies, usually the highlight of the market, are inexplicably spoiled, causing murmurs and rumors. Right at the beginning, we meet Bolo, who is another halfling living in the town, who is apparently, you know, and I have him overtly or overly praising his own pies at the beginning.
Guy that stole the knife.
Right, okay. Exactly. So later on, we find out that, he's the guy that stole the knife. Then he sort of starts following her. And now the thing that I thought was, I guess, a little bit different and maybe interesting is that if you scroll to the very end of this document, page 15, we have memories.
Wow.
Now, I set up this thing so that every time he bumped into a particular thing or a certain aspect of halfling life and twaddle, certain things would trigger these memories, and the memories were designed to fill him. I'm basically trying to fill out his character, fill out who he is, so that when he goes back to playing his character in the campaign, he's got an idea of what happened to him. Who is this person? He's got all these new memories, like the stuff that he can, well, not new memories, they're old memories. You know what I'm saying?
So are these the things that you said you were going to need permission from him for?
Some of them were. And I mean, the other one, of course, was the big one was Polly being his girlfriend and that whole backstory. That was the big thing that I really needed permission for, because I didn't want to sort of say, hey, you had a girlfriend and she's, you know, this is her, you know.
Yeah.
He might not agree with that. Maybe, I don't know, for any reason.
Yeah.
So going through the memories, the first one is the harvest homecomings, right? So the trigger was the aroma of festival foods. And so walking through twaddle, the sense of baking and cooking transports you back to your childhood days. You remember the warmth of your family kitchen bustling with activity as everyone prepared for the harvest festival. The shared anticipation, blah, blah, blah. So, you know, sort of setting up how important the harvest festival is to the character.
Right.
Because a lot of times I think that if you don't make it clear to the player, they won't incorporate these things into their role playing.
Right.
You know, if they don't, they might not even think of it, or they don't care, or they haven't considered how it might work. And I think players usually, if you give them something that they can get their teeth into, that they can use in their role playing, they will take it because they love it. That's what they want.
Yeah.
So helping them do that.
That's something that I really like that you've done here. I know we've only touched on the one memory, but like sense, you know, your five senses, and just the smelling of something is such a strong trigger for people in normal life. And so the fact that you've incorporated something like that, I think will stick with him, so that if that kind of scent ever happens again, it triggers this memory again, as if it really happened to him, which I really love. And also, like you said, with players, I think the idea, the concept of role-playing is so, it's such a grand thing, I think, like you said, that if you don't give them even just something little to grab onto, a lot of people, I think, can be really intimidated by role-playing. But if you give them something small, like this, a scent, and now they can latch onto it and they can make that grow.
And I mean, I had the opportunity to say, okay, here are all your memories and just learn them. You know, this is the backstory for your character, because this, I need you to know these are the facts you need to understand the adventure.
Right.
And so it's basically, in film terms, expositional dialogue is what it is. You know, it's exposition.
Yeah.
And so most people don't ingest exposition very easily. So when you're breaking it down and attaching it to particular triggers and senses, like you say, like smell, really helps in that way, you know? So, So the second one was, the trigger was the sight of the pumpkin patches, the sprawling pumpkin patches, blah, 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 excitement of hiding among the gourds, you know, nothing too fancy there, but we're getting into like the tone of the location.
Mm-hmm.
The festival lanterns set off a memory, recalling an evening, blah, 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 not too important, but clarity of purpose, a humbling trial. The edge of the woods, he remembers feeling a sense of being watched at the edge of the woods, right?
From
a long time ago. And that's sort of hinting at the fact that there is a hag in the forest.
There's something, yeah.
And they've always been there, you know, but he never knew what it was. But it gives him a, you know, some of these memories are clues to how to follow the adventure through as well, right?
Yeah. I love this.
The first spark of healing, the trigger is, you know, the town healer's presence. So seeing the town healer reminds him of the first time that he channeled Yondala's power to heal a wounded bird, for example. So there's a really specific memory of healing a bird. That was the first time he used his healing spells.
Right. Guys, folks, this is how many pages total? This is 17 pages for a solo player, you know, backstory
it's one session. It's
yeah.
One session game.
This is fantastic. This is a great template, I think. I actually might use this for myself because, as we've talked about on other shows, you know, is when you don't have your players show up as what happened to you and you only have one player, why waste that time, right? Don't wait for another session where you might not get everybody. Like, go ahead and play.
Go ahead and play. I mean, I don't know if we've done an episode on what to do if your players don't turn up, but we absolutely should. You know, because there are options like this.
Yeah.
You can play another role-playing game. You can play a different character. You can do it, whatever. Anyway. So,
I love this. Did you have to use the Deus Ex Machina?
No. I actually didn't have to use the Deus Ex Machina. It worked really well. It worked quite perfectly. Jerry really loved it. He was... He printed out this map for me.
He's the one who made that. That's
nine
great.
A4 pages of that that he's put together. That's like almost
awesome.
Huge.
Is the Deus Ex Machina in this document, or did you just have it in your head?
No, it's in the document.
It's
in here. We have it now. Let's just go back through so we've got the non-player characters section, narrative conclusion. This has also got, if you open the PDF, you'll note it should have a contents thing down on the left-hand side.
Yes.
Okay, so scene 3 in Act 2, encountering the celestial stag. As Jilyara contemplates his next move, a majestic stag with radiant antlers appears, its presence calming yet awe-inspiring the celestial creature. A guardian of the spirit of the forest offers a silent nod to Jilyara. Now, actually, I did use it in the sense that at this point in the story, when we actually ran it, he followed her into the woods, but then he lost her. Now, the thing was, she was following this toad that had been speaking to her. So he knew he was looking for her. He didn't know where she was. The festival was going to fall apart because she wasn't cooking the pies. So everyone's like, you got to talk to her. So he goes looking for her. He can't find her. And then he goes through his memories. Eventually it triggers a memory of when they were young and in love, they used to sit underneath this particular bridge. And so he goes, she might be under the bridge. So he goes to under the bridge. And of course, that's where she is. And she's talking to this toad, this huge toad. And it's speaking to her in like, this nasty kind of voice. And so he's like, what the fuck? So he follows the toad, goes off into the forest. She follows the toad and he follows her. So they're all off in the forest. They get lost in the forest, or he gets lost in the forest trying to follow them. There was a little bit, the one thing that was tricky was, kind of, there was a point where he wasn't going to follow her, or he was going to intervene too quickly, and I really had to balance that. So if you do choose to run this for whatever reason, I don't know why you would, but if you did, keep that in mind, because there are points in the story where on paper it looks like, oh, this will just follow through,
right?
But then when the player does it, you're like, okay, I didn't kind of anticipate this reaction from the player. So I did have to kind of fuck with it a little bit, but not too much. But he gets into the woods and then he gets lost. And I part of the reason I got him lost was because I didn't want him to go back to the town and get a bunch of help.
Yeah.
Right. There are a group in Twaddle, the guardians of Twaddle, the halflings in Twaddle, who are the security or the city watch or the guard, if you like, are called the bounders because they do the boundaries. Right. And so we didn't want him going and finding the bounders and coming back. So he gets lost. And then when he's lost, the white stag turns up. And, you know, the sort of baseline idea is that,
uh-oh,
my camera's being a shit. Okay.
Come on. Right at the very end.
Here we go.
There we go.
The point was that the stag was there to be set up, as you said before, Chekhov's gun, in case I needed it to save his ass at the end.
Right.
But at this point, I also was already going to include it, and he was lost. So eventually the stag gave him a hint as to where to go. Follow that path. And I'm like, you know, go that way.
Go that way, dummy.
Yeah. So that's what I did use the stag for in the end. So then he follows her through, and he comes across her, and she's in this... in this glade talking to this hag, and at first he doesn't realize this. So well, I used the hag in some interesting ways too, because during the fight with the hag, I had the hag turn invisible, and so he used spirit guardians, which worked really nicely because the hag tried to move around behind him, but the spirit guardians fucked her no matter where she went. So that worked nicely. But then she, at the end, by the time she had like 4 hit points, I'm like, okay, I don't want to, she's going to get out of this and come back and try a different approach. So she leaves, and then he has a moment where he's sort of trying to get Polly to snap out of her curse, which she's under, the spell that she's under. And then Polly's mother comes wandering into the glade, like she's followed her there. And I'm role-playing Polly's mother up the wazoo, you know, like, you know, how dare you, what are you doing to my daughter, blah, blah, blah. And he's just accusing him of all this shit. But this is the hag in
disguise. Oh, wow.
Right? And then Giliara's kind of realizing that she might be the hag, because there was it's too weird, the coincidence, the hag disappears, this person turns up. But what if it is her mother? What if he kills her in front of Polly? How's Polly going to react? You know, so he can't kill her immediately. So he has to draw her out first.
Yeah.
So that turned into a really interesting scenario and situation. Yeah, fascinating stuff. So that's kind of how I used it and what we did with it. And
did you record this and put this on your channel?
Unfortunately, no. This was a live face-to-face game.
Oh, you know, man, I'm dying to know what happened.
It's even more absurd because, you know, if I put all this work into this one adventure and I didn't even stream it.
Oh, man. Tell him that was really great. Let's do it again. More feeling.
Yeah, you're right.
Anyway, folks, I think this is the perfect time to wrap up this episode, but I am so glad that Russell shared this, because I mean, whether or not you're going to be using a halfling, this is a great template, I think, for just a one-on-one game to do a backstory for someone. The fact that it is built for a halfling is great, because now you can, you know, draw upon this for some inspiration. That was wonderful. Thank you so much for sharing that.
No worries.
I'm definitely going to give this a try.
I hope it's useful. I mean, yeah. I mean, obviously you won't, you could try and run this adventure the way it is, but.
Yeah. I mean, I would have to tailor it. If I'm using it for somebody's backstory, I'm going to have to tailor it.
You get the gist. I'll also say that I did this in an afternoon using ChatGPT as an assistant. I put in all the names. It was my story. I had all the main concepts and ideas ready to go. You know, GPT just
organized it. Yeah. Yeah.
And filled out basic stuff, you know, that was helpful.
Yeah.
So it's doable. And that's my approach. So good luck to you.
Wonderful. 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 All right, folks, we're going to go ahead and wrap up Halfling. And guess what? I didn't have this ready to see what our topic will be next time, because we are covering the various different races in the player's handbook. And watch me as I draw out this ending. Here we go. Oh, do you want to do an episode on human? We're going to do an episode on human.
Are we?
I don't know. How do we? Should we? This is a good question, because it will either be human or dragonborn. I think we should maybe save human for the end. What do you say? We're going to change the order. And then we, after we do all the other races, we can decide if human is something worth tackling.
Right. Okay.
I mean, if anything, it sounds like it would just be a pro con list about why you should or shouldn't play as a human. But we'll find out. So then,
and to be fair, I think it's like every race that we do, we kind of compare to humans anyway.
Right. This is true. We're kind of covering humans every...
It's part sort of the baseline there. So
I guess here's the thing, folks. If you want an episode on human, let us know. Otherwise, we're just going to make our own decision on it. So recap, rewind. We're going to cover Dragonborn next time. That's going to be really cool, because now we're talking about a race that's not even like humanoid. So, well, I guess it depends on your definition of humanoid, because they walk upright, but they don't have
they're not mammals.
Yeah. Anyway, all right, we're going to end on that note, folks. Okay. It was wonderful having you here with us to talk about.
They don't have nipples.
Halflings, they don't.
Dragonborn.
Oh.
I don't have nipples.
Well, let's talk about that in length next time. Put that in your notes, folks. All right. We will talk with you next time. Have a wonderful night, and thank you.
Adios. Zaijian. Goodbye.
Goodbye.